of eternal life. Let's go to Ezekiel. Because we start reading the Word, and if we make a conscious effort, a conscious decision to obey the Word, we recognize that we're not doing it alone. Ezekiel 36, excuse me, verses 24 through 27. For I will take you from among the heathen and gather you out of all countries and will bring you into your own land. Then will I sprinkle clean water upon you, and ye shall be clean from all your filthiness and from all your idols will I cleanse you. A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you, and I will take away the stony heart of your flesh, and I will give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes. And you shall keep my judgments and do them. Our Father has given us a perfect word that leads the way to our own perfection, in which is all wisdom, if we but obey it and follow it, because Christ did so and continues to do so in us. We oftentimes have lived by what we see and based our judgments on things that we see, and we've missed and been blinded to spiritual aspects. Salvation is an issue of the heart, John. And it's only if we peruse these scriptures, only if we obey these scriptures, that that word penetrates our hearts. Changes us from the inside out. As Ezekiel prophesied that God planned to do from the very beginning. I will give you a new heart so that you can keep my statutes. You won't have, as Paul says, in 2 Corinthians 3, have to rely on tablets of stone. The word will be written on the table of your heart, saying that as God wrote the Ten Commandments in the Old Testament with his finger, if we but obey the word, God inscribes it in our heart. And we witness to that in our very lives because we're living by it. And that's what we have to do as men. We always have to make sure that our life, our model, lines up with the specs, John. If there's a defect in a house, you fix it. This is our spec. Because we're not building something that's going to perish and fall away. We're building something that God desires should last forever. Should be perfect. Without spot or blemish, without wrinkle. So what ways are we not doing what God calls us to do? The thing that we need to think about, that in this word is everything that pertains unto life and godliness. The first thing we have to recognize is it's its perfection before we can move on. You don't get off the highway on an exit if you don't think that exit will lead you to where you're desiring to go. similarly with the word. Reading it and obeying it is getting off on the exit to ensure, one, you're on the right road, so that you can see your way forward. Now, I recognize that there are tremendous obstacles to obeying the word, to reading the word. But we have to cultivate in and of ourselves the discipline every day. Because, as Mondrian rightly states, we have folk who are looking at us, who are seeking to follow our example. Because we know that if we don't do this, there are terrible repercussions. Because the second part of salvation, recognizing that we're delivered from evil, is that we are delivered from the wrath of God. And just to make the correlation very quickly, let's go to Revelations 21:8. But the fearful and unbelieving and the abominable and murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers and idolaters and all liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. This is why salvation is a choice that each of us has to make every day. This is why we have to understand the importance that if we veer off the road but one bit, then our integrity is put into question, and more to the point, God's integrity is called into question. Do we value the mantle that God desires for us to take up that lightly? That we're willing to pay God homage with our lips and not offer him the life service that the word of God demands, that the word of God witnessed to when the word of God walked the face of the earth? 1 John 3:16, as Mark is referenced, because he laid down his life for us, so ought we also to lay down our lives for the brethren. But it's not constituted in simply laying down our lives for those people we're comfortable with, that we're affiliated with, that we're in relationship with, our family members. It's in laying down our lives for whomever God says to lay down our lives for. Because our house, as I said a few moments ago, is not limited to the four walls where we lay our heads every night. Ours is a global ministry, a universal ministry that speaks to the issues that confront every man, woman, and child on the face of this earth. Sin. Now, I don't know about you, but I value the covenant that God made with us in us. You see, we don't look at the word of God as a contract, as a covenant. God obligated himself to us. The God who is so much more became so much less, a slave, so that we could be called sons of God. Now what happens when you break a contract? Subject to be sued, penalized. You don't get what you agreed to in the contract. If you breach the contract,
wow.
You don't get the promise. See, in Exodus 24, Moses sprinkled the blood of the covenant on the Israelites, signifying God's desire to be in relationship with them. obligating them to obey.